हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, माई सेल्फ कल्पना सागर, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, सीओ डिपार्टमेंट, काइट ग्रुप ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूशन. इन टूडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट बस, इट्स आर्किटेक्चर एंड इट्स टाइप. लेट्स हैव अ लुक ऑन मेजर हाईलाइट्स ऑफ टूडेज लेक्चर, इन विच स्टूडेंट्स आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट बेसिक्स ऑफ बस, इट्स आर्किटेक्चर, टिपिकल बस ट्रांजेक्शन, टाइप्स ऑफ बसेस, एंड एट द एंड द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ बसेज ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ द पर्सनल कंप्यूटर. एट द एंड ऑफ दिस वीडियो लेक्चर student would be able to understand the concept of bus and its related topic. What is bus? As you see, a bus on a road, it generally carries you as a passenger from one location to the another location. In the same way, within the computer system, data needs to be transmitted from one subcomponent to the another subcomponent. Now, these subcomponents are memory, IO devices and CPU. So, we can say that bus is nothing but it is a set of wires that act as a shared but a common data path to connect multiple subcomponents within the computer system. These wires are also called as line. Each line carries a signal of 1 or 0 in the form of information which can be an address or data. You can also say that bus consists of multiple lines allowing the parallel movement of the bits. In the class, students generally do ask me, ma'am, practically, how does this bus look like? If we talk about the example of buses, we have industry standard buses like ISA, EISA and PCI. ISA is a industry standard architecture which is a 16-bit internal bus of IBM PC. EISA stand for Extended Industry Standard Architecture, whereas the full form of this PCI is Peripheral Component Interconnect. PCI is a local bus which was first implemented in IBM PC compatible. This PCI is a local computer bus for attaching the hardware devices in a computer system. This is the pictorial representation of the PCI and the ISA bus. As you can notice, on this board, we have the 2 slots for PCI and 3 slots for ISA. This is the another pictorial representation of the PCI in which we have the 3 slots for the PCI. We have certain parameters related to this bus. These parameters are speed, clock speed and the width of the bus. The speed of the bus is affected by its length as well as by the number of the devices sharing it. The size of a bus, or you can say the total number of the lines in a bus known as its width, that determines how much data can be transmitted at one time. For example, if we have a bus of 32 bit, then that bus can transmit only 32 bits of data. Is this width of the bus fixed? Can't be. The width varies as it depends on the way the system has been developed. Another parameter is the clock speed. Every bus has a clock speed which gets measured in megahertz or gigahertz. If a bus is fast, then it means it allows the data to be transferred in a faster mode, which also makes application to run faster. It must be clear now, why do we require bus? Bus is required so as to have the effective communication and to establish the connection between the subcomponents of the computer system. Secondly, the CPU can effectively communicate with the other component with the help of this bus. Bus also makes it easy to connect new devices to each other. Now let's discuss advantages and disadvantages of the bus. Common bus has an advantages as it has the low cost and very versatile in nature, whereas it has a disadvantage too, and that disadvantage is at any time only one device can be a bus. However, this sharing often result in the communication bottleneck. Now, what do you mean by this communication bottleneck? Communication bottleneck is a point where the flow of data is entirely stopped. Let's discuss the bus architecture. A typical bus consists of data, address, control and the power lines. First is data line. These lines of a bus are dedicated for moving the data, and the collection of these lines which are carrying the data is called as the data bus. These data lines contain the actual information that must be moved from one location to the another. For example, from IO devices to memory or from processor to memory. Each line carries one bit at a time. So, the number of line in the data bus determines how many bits can be transferred parallelly. In this way, the width of the data bus determines the overall system performance. Next, we have the address line. Address lines indicate the address from where the data should be either read or written to. These address lines specify where to store the data and from where to retrieve the data present on the data bus. The width of the address bus determines the memory capacity such that the total number of unique addresses or the locations. Next lines under the bus architecture are power lines. Power lines, they are used to provide the electrical power supply which is necessary within the computer system. Last we have control lines. Control lines are used to control the access to the address bus, data bus and to monitor their use. Control lines also indicate which device has the permission to use the bus and for what purpose, such that reading or writing from the memory or from input-output devices. These lines are also responsible for transferring the acknowledgement that are generated in response of the bus request and the interrupts, etc. If any device like memory, I/O device or the CPU sends the request for the bus access, then it gets acknowledged by this control line. Now, it must be clear, why do we require control lines? Control lines are required, it is simply because address bus and data bus are shared between the components and we require a mechanism to control their use. So, next question is, how does the control bus ensure their proper usage? It can be ensured by the control signal that are generated by the control bus. These control signal transmit two type of information via signal. The first is your timing signal and another is your command signal. The first timing signal tells the validity of the data and address on the data bus and the address bus respectively. Whereas the second signal, which is your command signal, specify which operation is to be performed. There are total 11 control signals. First one is memory write, second memory read, I/O write, I/O read. We have transfer acknowledgement, bus request, bus grant, interrupt request, interrupt acknowledge, clock and reset. This is one of the control signal which is required when we have the data on the data bus which needs to be written on the memory. Whereas in the case of memory read, we have the data which is there in the memory and that data needs to be read and it should be put on the data bus. Another control signal are I/O write, in which the data which is available on the data bus needs to be written on the I/O port. On the other hand, we have I/O read, in which the data which is either provided by the user or through the I/O port can be read on the data bus. Next, we have transfer acknowledgement. Control signal indicates the successful transmission of the data. The sixth control signal is the bus request. When the various subcomponents request to gain the control of the bus, in response to the bus request, bus grant signal is enabled that grants the control of the bus to the subcomponents of the computer system. Next control signal is the interrupt request, which is responsible for handling the pending request of the interrupt. In response to the interrupt request, we have another control signal, that is your interrupt acknowledgement, and this interrupt acknowledgement is responsible for ensuring whether the pending interrupts are recognized or not. The 10th control signal is a clock, that is required for the synchronization of the operation within the computer system. At last, we have the reset control signal that is used to initialize the multiple modules which are available within the computer system. Moving on to the discussion of typical bus transaction, that includes first the sending of an address for performing the read or the write operation. After sending that address, a transferring of data from memory to a register is to be taken, that is called as the memory read, and the transferring of the data to the memory from a register also takes place, that is called as memory write. Buses can also be used for IO reads and writes from the peripheral devices. Each type of transfer occurs within a bus cycle. Bus cycle, it is the time between two ticks of the bus clock. This is the block diagram of the component of a typical bus, where we have CPU, memory modules, IO modules, and all these subcomponents are interconnected with the help of this bus structure, which consists of control line, address line, and data line. Let's discuss different types of buses. First, we have point-to-point buses. A bus can be point-to-point, means that it is connecting the two specific components. Second, we have multi-point buses. This multi-point buses can be a common pathway that connects a number of devices, requiring these devices to share the bus. The third type of bus is processor memory buses. These buses are short, high speed that are closely matched to the memory system on the machine so as to maximize the bandwidth, which is nothing but the transfer of the data. These types of buses are usually design specific. The fourth type of buses are IO buses. These buses are typically longer than processor memory buses and allow for many types of devices with varying bandwidth. These buses are also compatible with different types of architectures. Next, we have backplane bus, which is built into the chassis of the machine and connects the processor, IO devices, and the memory. So, all the devices are on the single bus. The next type of bus is the dedicated bus and multiplex bus. Dedicated bus is permanently assigned either to a particular function or to a physical subset of the computer component. Whereas in the case of the multiplex bus, we have common bus that is used for both data and address transmission. Dedicated bus have various advantages as it involves high throughput and less waiting time. On the other hand, multiplex buses are advantageous as it uses fewer lines, which results in less cost and space. Now let's discuss the disadvantages of these buses. Dedicated bus is of high cost as it involves larger bus size. On the other hand, this multiplex bus has the reduced performance due to the more complex circuit. Seventh type of bus is single bus and multiple bus. Generally, simple computer designs move data on a single bus. Multiple buses, however, vastly improve the performance. In multiple bus architecture, each pathway is suited to handle a particular kind of information. Buses can be further classified on the basis of the personal computer. First is internal or the system bus. These buses connect the CPU, memory, and all other internal components. The second type of bus is external or expansion bus. These buses connect external devices, peripheral, expansion slot, and IO ports to the rest of the computers. These buses are slower, but it allows for the more generic connectivity. Third classification is local bus or data bus. These buses connect a peripheral device directly to the CPU. These buses are high special buses that can be used to connect only a limited number of similar devices. That's all about the bus concepts. See you soon in the next lecture. Till then, keep smiling and happy learning. Thank you.